excited to be here with you this morning. You know, if this is your first time, your fifth time, your 10th time, or your 100th, we are so excited to be able to celebrate with you. I wanted to be able to set the stage here a little bit this morning before we praise and worship. I was reflecting in scripture on Palm Sunday. That's right, that's last week. And I was thinking about how that's Jesus' triumphal entry. And listen, he had not even gone to the cross yet. And I was focusing in on the bystanders in that portion of scripture, where scripture says that they were laying down the palm branches for Jesus. And I want you to know something. The palms are a symbol of victory. So see, at that moment when Jesus was riding in on the donkey to Jerusalem, had not even gone to the cross yet, what the bystanders were saying is, oh, you're gonna be victorious, Jesus. You are the champion. You have not gone yet, but we know you have already overcome. See, they were in a position of faith on that morning. And if that doesn't make any sense to you, Christianity may be new to you. Listen, it's no different than today. When you go to your favorite sporting event and you root for your team, you go in advance saying, oh, I know my team's gonna win. I know my team has got this. And that is no different. But today, we celebrate from a different standpoint, and it is this, that Jesus has already overcome. So we have every reason to shout and to cheer. So when you're clapping this morning, when you are giving your best praise, when you're lifting your hands, you remember those palms and you say, listen, Jesus, all victory is yours. All victory is here already, and I am the benefactor of that. That's me. And that's you. We are champions because of Jesus. Let's celebrate this morning.
All hail the Lord. Danielle talked about. All hail the King, hands lifted high in adoration. King Jesus, oh, all hail the Savior of the world. Oh, the Savior, my Jesus,
and we sing hallelujah.
King, we celebrate our risen Savior. What a gift to be here today, to worship and adore Him, to lift our hands in adoration, to lift our voices in praise. So let's give Him all that we have today, holding back nothing from Him.
Blessed assurance, and Jesus is mine. Sing it out. He's been my fortress in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit and washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary's burden enough. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission. I know the author of
He heard and answered.
Why Jesus? Why all the talk of crucifixions and the resurrection of the dead? The idea that our present reality can be radically transformed by one historical day from antiquity. Why does this one event persist to shake nations, stands against kingdoms, relentlessly remaining there in every test in time? Why does the life of one rabbi bring hope to the billions and peace beyond understanding, peace even in facing death? His axioms transcend culture, moving between and among every generation, offering new grace with each day to the poor and to the rich, to the young and to the old, each who calls his name. This is not just a page between the chapters of history, neither myth, metaphor, nor a line of spectacular exaggeration. His influence on every human life story is unfit to be placed into any existing category. No, Jesus isn't written into our story. Rather, our story is written into his. Every authority, even the grave, obeys his sovereign will. This is why we exalt the mighty name of Jesus over and over and over again. His victory has given us life. His mercies stand at the center of our faith. He alone holds the pen of history. He is the one true God, and at that, a God who died for us. Why rejoice? Why is this our anthem? The answer for why Jesus comes down to this. Jesus is at the center. His victory over the grave is written into every line, between old and new, between death and life. There stands one historical reality, the resurrection of Jesus.
I see lightning, I hear thunder.
Do you see what I see?
Lifesong Church, and happy Easter. Hope you guys are doing well today. My name is Paul. For those of you who don't know me, I serve as our campus pastor here at our Sutton campus. And we recognize on Easter weekend that many of you are new. You're visiting with friends or family members, or maybe you found us on your own because you were just looking for a church to attend on Easter. But for those of you that are new, however you got here, we want you to know that we're so glad you're here. And I want to invite you at some point during our service to grab this guest card. It's located in the seat back pocket in front of you. That card's there for you to be able to tell us a little bit about yourself and how we can better serve you. Then after service, you can take this card over to Guest Central, which is on the far side of the foyer. In front of that big book wall that says God's writing your story. Our team will be there after service. I'll be there as well, and we'd love to connect with you, all right? This time in our service, coming out of worship, is where we pray together over our giving. And we do that intentionally coming out of worship because we see our giving as an act of worship. It's part of how we honor God as the source of everything that he's entrusted to us. And it's one of the best ways that we can respond to him and give back to him in response to all that he's done for us, all that he's given for us, in making it possible for others to hear the good news of Jesus, allowing him to channel resources through us for that purpose. And there's a few ways you can do that here at Lifesong. You can text to give using the number on the screen behind me. You can set up your giving through our website, which is lifesongonline.org, or through the Church Center app, which is an app we use around here for a lot of things. You can even grab one of those envelopes in the seat back pocket in front of you, fill that out, and then drop it on the tithes and offerings boxes on your way out. All right, let's go ahead and pray over our giving here today. Father, we thank you for the resources that you have entrusted to us, Lord. Today we recognize you as the source of all of it. And we thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Son and the privilege of celebrating his resurrection on our behalf here today. And today, in response to that, we take a portion of what you put in our hands, we put it back into yours to further the name of Jesus in this region, continue to draw those to you who don't yet know you. And Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness that as we trust you with what you put in our hands, you promise to meet our needs with all sufficiency, so we'll have an abundance for the good works you desire to do through us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What is going on, everyone? My name is Pablo Rivera. I'm the production director here at Lifesong, and I am at the conference room at Votary Films because we are planning, we are dreaming, we are preparing for Summer XP. And if you're looking at me and you're like, you're a stranger, I don't know who you are. Also, what is Summer XP? Well, you're in luck because, as I told you, my name is Pablo Rivera, so now we're friends, we're not strangers. And secondly, you want to know about Summer XP? Boy, do I have something for you. Check this out. That is Summer XP. It's our summer kids experience. And if you're looking at that and you're saying, wow, I need to register my child for that. First of all, you are absolutely right. Astute observation. Here's why you got to register right now, though. Because right now and up until April 7th, if you register your child for Summer XP, we're getting $5 off. That's right, $5 off of your registration, but only if you register before April 7th. So if that video spoke to you like it has spoken to me, you got to register your child today. They will thank you for it. Trust me. And I mean, the hours without your kid in the summertime, I'm not saying anything. I'm saying maybe you need that. Go ahead and register your child for Summer XP today. And now you can take a moment to check into Lifesong Church on Facebook. Take a moment and do that. I will dive right into our Easter experience.
from noon until 3 in the afternoon,
darkness came over all the land. And about 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing there heard this, they said, he's calling Elijah. And immediately one of them ran and got a sponge and filled it with wine vinegar and put it on a staff and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him. And when Jesus had cried out in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. And at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook. The rocks split. The tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. And when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and they exclaimed, surely he was the Son of God. On this Easter, we celebrate a risen Lord, but our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, went through a brutal experience, a journey that none of us could imagine. And in a moment of his passing, as he declared things were finished and he gave up his spirit, the Lord acted in the most powerful and magnificent way that anyone had seen up to that moment. And on Easter, if we're not careful, we'll be so celebratory of the open tomb that we'll miss the magnificence of what just happened 3 days prior. And on this Easter morning, I want to help you see Easter unveiled. If you're here at Lifesong today, and maybe you don't know the story of Jesus, my hope is to help you understand a little bit more about what Jesus went through and just exactly the scope of his great love for you. Now, I know that for many of you, when you come to church, this is maybe your home church and you're just excited to be here to worship Jesus. For some of you, maybe you've come from somewhere else and you moved to the area and you're looking for a church and you're here with us today. But I know for some of you, you're here at church on Easter because your parents promised you brunch. Because a girlfriend or a boyfriend said, if we're gonna hang out today, church comes first. And so you said yes, and you're here. And I just want you to know that I believe that however it is that you made it here today, you didn't end up here by accident. The story of Jesus' life and death and resurrection is magnificent, and you probably know pieces of it, but the story of his passing on the cross that then, over the next 3 days, was a waiting period before we celebrate today the moment of his resurrection, an empty tomb, a completed work, has a powerful moment when Jesus is on the cross. And I read it for you, but I want you to hear this today. God loved you so deeply that he literally moved heaven and earth to prove it to you. The God of the universe could have done any number of things, any number of ways to demonstrate his love for you, but he literally moved heaven and moved earth to show you how much he loves you. There's no doubt about it. The story of Jesus' moment on the on the cross is the story of his coming to the end, declaring it is finished. And as I read, as I walked out, in the moment that he did, darkness had been over the land for 3 hours. Like, there was no light. The Lord had effectively blotted out the sun. Effectively, he'd moved the heavens to close off light from the land as a declaration of the darkest day in history. And then after stopping the light from shining, he shakes the ground. Everybody stomp your feet. Imagine standing nearby the cross when the ground begins to shake. Everybody begins to look around and wonders what is happening. He moved heaven and he shook the earth. And then it says that the temple veil was torn from the top to the bottom. There's so much we need to talk about with relation to the veil. The veil is a word that's used all through Scripture. We read about veil use in the Old Testament. If you're a Christian, you've seen the word veil. You've read about when Moses had to put a veil over his face because he'd met with the Lord and his countenance was changed. And like, we read about veils. We read about veils in the New Testament and head coverings for women. And we read about veils. Jesus speaks of things like veils being over their eyes and our heart being veiled. Like, it's not a surprise term. It's a very biblical term. And the term veil and the veil itself is used as a separation state. It's a thing that's intended to cause one side from being disconnected from the other side. It's a separator, and it says this part stays in and this part stays out. There's a veil in the temple. It was torn. Have you ever tried to tear fabric? Anybody ever tear, like you had to rip fabric for something? How many of you ever watched professional wrestling? Some of you are like, really, Easter to wrestling? You ever watched professional wrestling? You ever watched like when someone, a sport, you know, an athlete or a wrestler, they're athletes, but they have a moment where they're just all wound up. Like they're jacked, they're lit up. And they go and they grab their shirt. Some of you are like, is he really gonna? No, I'm not gonna rip my shirt. You don't need to see my Spanx, so just leave it alone. And they rip their shirt open. What are they doing? They're demonstrating, or attempting to demonstrate, their incredible power. They want you to fear them. So we have a human understanding of this tearing and ripping away as a demonstration of authority and power. The veil that was in the temple was not like any veil you might think of. The veil that was in the temple is not a piece of cotton. It's not easily torn linen. It's not even like some of our heavy-duty upholstery. It's certainly not like the fabric of these drapes. The veil in the temple was a 4-inch thick, multi-twined, multi-layered, 15-foot high, some commentators say 40-foot wide, like this massive veil. In fact, it was so significant, it took 300 priests to take it down and clean it when it became unclean. It was massive. It was torn from top to bottom. You say, well, Pastor David, where'd that veil come from? Well, in the Old Testament, we read the story of the Israelites coming out of Egypt, and Moses leads them out of Egypt, and they travel in the wilderness for 40 years, wander around. What should have taken them just a little while took them 40 years. Look at the person beside you and say, don't you lead me in the wilderness like that. How many of you have ever felt like you've been in the wilderness? Anybody ever have a feeling like that? You have a moment where you're in the wilderness. How many have ever been lost in the wilderness, like just out in the middle of the woods? Well, thank God someone found you. That's all I'm saying. Have you ever felt like a little bit of an emotional wilderness? Have you ever lived in a place where you feel dry and kind of like a spiritual wilderness? How many of you felt like a little bit of a marital wilderness? No, I'm just kidding. Don't raise your hand. The Israelites made their way through the desert for 40 years, but while they were wandering through the desert and they were seeking to get to the promised land and the Lord was leading them in all these crazy ways and providing manna for them, and some of you know the story, one of the things that the Lord demanded and ordered and orchestrated was this tabernacle that would be constructed and taken from place to place. They would travel a while, they'd set up camp, and they'd build this tabernacle, and the Lord was very specific about it. The number of posts and the number of drapes and the size and the shape and where it fit in the context of the million Hebrews that were wandering through the desert. And in it was a space, a veil that separated a place from another place. It separated a place where many could gather from a place where only one could go. It separated a place where you could be in the temple, in the tabernacle, but this holiest place, this holiest of holies, where the presence of God dwelt, was this very, it was this pure and holy place. And the Lord only invited one person into that space. He said that the high priest, the holiest of priests, only the holiest of priests who'd been anointed and trained and raised up and picked, and he'd been elevated to this high priestly place. It was his job to take care of the sins of all of the camp. And in order to do that, he had to go in and bring sacrifice to God in this place before God alone. There was a veil that separated the place anyone could be from the place only he could be. And so he would have to go and get himself right before he could go in. And this same thing translated into the temple in Jerusalem. And they constructed the temple, and in the temple was this veil. It was a continuation of this covenant of God, whereby the people of Israel, that would be like you and me, the average person, could not meet with God personally. They had to have someone take care of it for them. And so they would bring their own little sacrifices. They would buy a pigeon or a dove or a goat or a sheep. They would do what they did. But the priest, the high priest, would go and make himself pure. And then he would go into the Holy of Holies, this special intimate place where the presence of God was. And he would sacrifice to the Lord on behalf of the nation and take care of the whole nation. This was the practice. But then Jesus. Some of you are here on Easter Sunday and you're saying to yourself, you know, woo, I didn't know that. Some of you are saying, I didn't realize the way that went. And man, I'm one of those people that probably could never have gone in because I'm pretty messy. Look at the person beside you, say, you're a little bit messy. Look at the person on the other side and say, but you look good on Easter. Go ahead. See, everybody in Israel knew that the high priest had to do the final work. Everybody in Israel knew that the culmination of the journey was the high priest going in to meet with God. And Jesus, when he lives and goes through the Passion Week, which we've just come through, the moment of lifting palms and laying down palm branches, celebrating, save us, expecting a great conquering king. And the week of Passion where Jesus was met with his disciples, he prayed and asked God to take things away from him. He was captured in a garden, taken before Pilate. He was tried unjustly and found guilty of no actual crime. He was sentenced to be crucified while they released a career criminal, murderer going free while Jesus is sentenced to a murderer's death. And then they beat him and whip him and put a crown of thorns upon his head. He's bleeding and broken, mocked. And they put a cross on his back and he carries it up a hill to the top of the hill, Golgotha, where he's nailed to it and erected on a cross between two other career criminals. And in the moment that Jesus is giving up his spirit and finishing, it is finished, finishing the first covenant and becoming the Lamb of God slain for the sins of the world, at that very moment, 3 p.m, the high priest and the other priests in the temple are in the temple. It's the time of sacrifice. See, they're in the temple preparing to do what they've always done. They're in the temple preparing to take care of the sacrifices that are to be offered before God. And there's a veil that is huge and they're aware of it. Those that can't go into the Holy of Holies are out in this area. They're doing the prayers and the rituals. They're preparing sacrifice. They're doing what they do. The high priest maybe is preparing to go into the very place on the other side of the veil where God is, but no one's allowed. And at the moment of Jesus passing on the cross, the Lord himself moves heaven, moves earth, and splits into, destroys the dividing veil. And all the priests watch it happen. They all prepare and look over and the veil is split. Any of them can now go into the place where God was, or more importantly, anybody can go into the place that God is, or maybe what we could say is the time has come when God is now available to all of us. See, the veil moment was not just a detail in the story. It was the manifestation of God's saying to you and me that our performance isn't that important. See, up until now, in order for Israel to be right, there was a performance construct that earned them what they thought was the love of God. And the high priest's failure meant that they weren't walking in the forgiveness of God or the blessing of God. And in the moment of the veil tearing, it's as if God was saying to you and saying to me that the performance isn't the point. See, you might be here and you're like, Pastor David, like, you don't know. God, I'm here for some other reason. God could never love me. Is that me? Is there another mic on somewhere? No? Okay. That was a rehearsed version of what the veil tearing sounded like. Maybe you're thinking to yourself, God of the universe that went through all that doesn't know my mess. The Israelites had all kinds of sins that God knew about. I don't know what they were, but they were probably bad, but they weren't as bad as mine. Maybe you're saying things to yourself like, you know, I once followed Jesus. I was raised to know God. And then something happened, my adolescence, you know, influences, college, whatever. I decided, no, forget God. I don't need him. Maybe you had a really, really, really hard moment in your life. Maybe you had a childhood journey that was traumatic and you've struggled with whether or not God could love you or whether you could love God. Maybe you had a broken marriage. And like, I know that marriage is ordained by God between one man and one woman and it's for life and divorce is not godly and you feel like, oh, God can't love me. I'm broken. Or maybe you got an addiction. You think, I don't want anybody to know. And I certainly don't want God to know. It doesn't matter what your baggage is. In the moment of the veil tearing, the Lord said this to you and me. He said, your performance cannot make me love you anymore. Jesus' performance did that. Your messy, broken state. That time when you went in for a car drive and you were upset with me and you were upset with life and you went through a really hard thing or you did something really bad and you were upset and you're like, screw you, God. I don't want anything to do with you. I don't believe in you. That time when you thought you were following God but you sinned really badly. You can't do enough right things that would make me love you any more than I already have. See, the love I have for you was poured out by me to build a way for you to me. You've been on the outside of the veil and you think you have to earn your right to the inside. And I'm saying to you, taking care of it all, I love you so much. that I moved heaven and earth to show you. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 9, it says, since we have now been justified, our debt has been justified. We no longer owe. It's been justified by his, that is Jesus' blood. And how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through Jesus? You say, Pastor David, I'm not sure how I feel about God anyway. I think God's kind of a mean guy. God seems like a kind of a big ogre who just wants to squish somebody. God's an angry God. He wants to do bad things. I just would like to be intellectually honest for a minute. Can we do that? Just look at the person beside you and say, I don't know what he just said. Go ahead. I just want to be intellectually honest. People say this to me sometimes. They'll say, Pastor David, I know the story. I know you're a pastor and you're supposed to love God. I'm like, well, I'm not supposed to, but I kind of do. And they'll say, here's my problem. God's an angry God. God just wants to hurt people. God's an ogre. He just wants to punish people. God doesn't do everything that people want. God doesn't show up where people are. He's just a mean God. So, screw him. I'm like, So let me walk through your logic with you for a minute. So your lens is, God is mean and angry and wants to hurt and punish people. And your choice as a result of seeing God through that lens is, I think I'll do all the things he doesn't like. God's bad. God's mean. God's gonna squish me, and God's powerful. So I'll just run away from him and do things that make him mad. That'll go well. Well, then, Pastor David, are you saying that we have to love God? I'm not saying you have to love God. In fact, God doesn't even say you have to love God. The Lord said that we actually get to choose to follow in the way of Jesus. What he said is, and I want you to choose it so desperately, I'll do anything and everything to prove that I love you. You don't have to receive it. You can run from it. But you can't go away and say, I didn't do everything I could. I moved heaven and I moved earth. And I put my son on the cross to take care of the debt you owe. Now you can think I don't love you, but I think it's very obvious that I do. And I would say to you today, the best news for you is that God made a way for you to know and experience the love that no longer requires the kind of performance to the song and dance. Hey God, you love me today? Pastor David, that's nice. But if you knew my story. Well, maybe you don't know this part of the story. When Jesus was nailed to a cross, he was stood up on his cross in between two criminals. These were two criminals, like the one that was freed, so he would end up on the cross. And while they were there, one of the criminals, this is in Luke chapter 23, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at Jesus and said, aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. In that moment, the criminal was saying to Jesus, you need to perform for our salvation. If you really want to be saved, perform. If you really can save, perform a miracle. Do something and save yourself. Let your performance prove your salvation. And the criminal on the other side rebuked him and said, don't you fear God since you were under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we're getting what our deeds deserve. In other words, we're getting what we earned. We're on this cross because we worked hard to get here. Our performance put us up here. But this man, he did nothing. We're getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. And then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Why is that so important? Because in this moment when Jesus is dividing the veil, he's living the covenant. In the moment when God is dividing the veil, Jesus is about to die. And as he's about to die, he lives the very covenant he's about to demonstrate and ratify by his death. And he says to a criminal who's performed so horribly, he's been incarcerated and deserves death. And as he sits on that cross, a moment where the veil is removed from his eyes. And he says, Surely you are the Son of God. Remember me. He said, I deserve to be here. I couldn't earn the rescue I'm now crying out for. But the veil's been removed, and he sees Jesus for who Jesus is, and he recognizes the love of God being poured out beside him. And Jesus in that moment doesn't say to him, well, hopefully you can get off this cross and pay some penance. Jesus doesn't say to him, you didn't pray the prayer right. Jesus didn't say to him, your church attendance has really been bad. Jesus didn't say to him, you know, you smoked pot last week. Mm-hmm. Jesus didn't say to him, you got a speeding ticket. Jesus didn't say to him, you cursed. Jesus didn't say to him, you've mistreated your husband or your wife. Jesus didn't say that. You cannot earn the love of God. The love of God is already poured out for you. And this criminal says, remember me in paradise. And Jesus in a moment says, I tell you this very day, you will be with me in paradise. Your brokenness doesn't keep you separated from God. There's a veil that you need to let be removed so you can say, I now see God. You say, Pastor David, that's great, but I know a lot of people who are followers of Jesus. Maybe heaven's already full. Here's what I want you to know. Relationship with God isn't a sold-out event. Relationship with God is not a sold-out event. 12 people in your family have come to Jesus progressively, and you're the one holdout. They didn't fill up the mansions in heaven, and now you're stuck far from God. I'm just telling you, it's not a sold-out event. I know you're used to sold-out events. We're used to places where the number of tickets expires, where the seats in the auditorium, they're all expired. The stadium may have 100,000 seats, but I still can't get in. I'm telling you, heaven is not a sold-out stadium, and relationship with God is not a sold-out event. Nobody, you're not going to get to heaven one day. You're going to die, and you're going to walk down the road and go, man, can I get in? No, sorry, Roseful. Hey, can I come in? No, Roseful. Hey, is that right? No. The Bible says that for God so loved the world, all of us, that he gave his one and only son. That whosoever, look at the person beside you and say, you're a whosoever. That whosoever might believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. The rescue that God poured out through Jesus is not lost on you. It was done for you. After Jesus is crucified and the veil is torn and holy people are resurrected, and it says they went into Jerusalem and many saw them. It's not just an embellishment of a story. Have you missed it? God darkened the sky, split a veil, he shook the earth, and he raised people from the dead in the moment of ending a covenant of works and moving us into a covenant of grace so that you don't have to perform to earn the love of God, so that you can live from a place of being loved by God. And then Jesus comes off that cross, and Joseph of Arimathea offers his tomb to bury Jesus in. And someone said to me, you know, why do you think Joseph of Arimathea, what do you think he said when people are like, really, you want to give up your tomb like that? And he's like, yeah, it's only going to be borrowed for a few days. They put Jesus in the tomb. 3 days later, his disciples show up, Mary and others. It says, but very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared, and they found that the stone had been rolled away, that earth had been moved again. And so they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes, and the women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. And then the men asked, why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day. And here's what I want you to hear on this Easter celebration, the day we celebrate the risen Lord Jesus, is that if we miss the power of what happened at the cross, we will lose the power of the exclamation at the tomb. If you miss what happened on the cross, you'll think, oh, it's Easter. Hey. Easter becomes just a nice thing to buy pretty dresses and get flowers. Easter is not about that. It's the exclamation point at the end of this power sentence. It's the moment, I believe, when an open tomb is for you and I the evidence of Jesus' promise of proximity. Up until now, they'd had to live far from God, but Jesus does what could be done by nothing or by anyone. He makes the veil no longer necessary. He's told his disciples, and he's telling us, for 3 years, abide in me, stay close to me, walk with me, learn from me, be near to me, cast your yoke upon me, let me take all your cares, don't worry about tomorrow, come and find rest for your soul, be near me. But all the Hebrews know is we can't get close to God. There's a veil. But because the tomb is empty, Jesus is not found there, we can trust that everything he's already said is true. You feel far from God? I'm telling you, feel far from God because you're trying to earn your way close. And every time you try and earn your way close, it's like you're grabbing the edge of this drape or the veil, and you're wanting to run over and get the other side and pull them together and get a giant-sized needle and start to sew the veil back together. No, God can't love me that much. God can't love me that much. I have to do some stuff. I have to earn God's love. No. The very thing that was intended to keep God in, it once held him in, we now can accidentally, unintentionally try and re-sew it to keep God out. But there are some burdens that are too big for our human strength to handle. And God, in his infinite wisdom and power, knew. The burden of proving and earning and working is too heavy a burden. I'll take the burden and I'll take the weight. And today what we celebrate is a risen Jesus who by his absence from the tomb declares for us, everything I've said is true, because if Jesus wasn't raised, then all of his declaration would be moot. He can't be God. He must not be God. Therefore, what can we trust? But because he's gone from cross to tomb, he's gone from power sentence to exclamation point. He's gone from opening the temple to opening the earth. He's come out of a grave, cannot be found, and then shows himself alive to 500 witnesses. Because of the resurrection, we can trust the life and message of the gospel. So my hope is that your awareness of Easter would be more than simply the lilies, the new suit, the declaration that he has risen, all of which are awesome. But don't miss what Jesus did and what he ratified in his life and crucifixion that is sealed and proven on this day. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for me? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 and 20, it says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. There are a lot of you that are here today that this is a celebration. It's the greatest day because once upon a time, a week, a month, 2 years, 2 decades ago, you gave your life to Christ You received the full measure of what he paid for on that cross. And every day we live from a place of that receiving, not a place of earning. But for many of you, you've never made the decision to do that. And so on this Easter, I have a question. If you've never made that decision, you've never chosen Jesus, you've never surrendered your life, you've never said, God, despite my performance and my mess and my brokenness, I now understand the gravity of what you did. I understand the scope of your love. I understand the magnitude of your desire to be close to me. And today, God, I want to surrender and receive that gift. If that's you, I'm going to count to three, and I want you to put your hand up real high and say, that's me today, Pastor. I'm saying yes to Jesus, that I'm receiving the gift today. If that's you right now on the count of three, put your hand up. One, two, three. Who would say that's me? Man, all over the place. Hands all over the place. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, if that's you, put your hand up. Maybe you've never even taken the step of putting a hand up and saying, yep, God, that's me. I'm receiving it today. If that's you, put your hand up. Just, that's me today. Thank you. Well, I'd love it if you'd put your hands down. And everyone in the room, everyone online at our campus in Worcester, everybody, I want you to pray this prayer nice and loud. Would you pray it with those that have raised their hands? Say, Heavenly Father, let me hear you say it. Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus. I thank you for sending him and that he died for me and for raising him back to life. Today, God, I ask you to forgive me for all of my sin. Would you make me new because of Jesus and not my good works? And today, Jesus, I surrender to you. I call you my Lord and my Savior. It's in your name I pray. Amen and amen. Can you celebrate with me? So many who are having the veil removed, saying yes to Jesus, stepping into new life in Christ. This is the day of Jesus' resurrection and new life in him.
Listen, if that's you, if you prayed that prayer to receive Jesus as your Savior here today, we're so excited for you. And you might be saying, now what do I do? Now what? Well, we've got these cards at the back of the auditorium. Our team members have them. We also have them on a guest center. They say, now what, on the front and on the back. They've got some very simple steps that you can take to get some people alongside you in your pursuit of a relationship with Jesus. We all need that. God never intended us to pursue a relationship with him on our own in a silo. He wants us to do that in the context of community. So we want to come alongside you in that. Also, we've got some resources we'd love to put in your hand. If you stop by Guest Central, we'd love to put a Bible in your hand, as well as a book called Fresh Start that's got some great insights that you'll find valuable as you get started in this journey with Jesus here today. All right. I want to invite you to stand to your feet. Let me bless you before we take off here today. All right. I bless you to walk in the fullness of life and freedom that Jesus purchased for you. And may you experience a vibrant relationship with your Heavenly Father in which you know you are seen, you are cared for, and you are deeply loved. Have a wonderful Easter, everybody.